sometimes we get the recurring coming, so we have a bunch of new fresh faces tonight for this event. It's probably my favorite event of the year. It's very interactive. We have Len Lonzi, who's the Executive Director of LAVA, which is the LA Venture Association, which is a huge networking group of angel investors, venture capitalists, as well as entrepreneurs to make connections in that community. So I'm the Chief Operating Officer of the Accelerator Program, which is, I think as we're sitting down, normally this is set up as a co-working space, and then we move it out, all the tables out, when we have events. But I'm also the Director of Marketing for Stubbs Alderton and Markley's. We're a full-service business law firm, so we do everything from incorporation, from inception, all the way through exit, or going public, whatever your path might entail, and litigation, which I hope you never have to address. It's a great firm to work for. We're really innovative. And so we've established this pre-accelerator program. Some of you may have seen the press that was in Variety and a few other publications this week. We're expanding the pre-accelerator. So far, we've had 22 companies go through the program over the last 4 years. 16 out of the 22 have become funded. So they're early stage. They're idea stage companies. They come as early as an idea on a napkin. We surround them with resources. We have over 50 mentors that come and actually dedicate their time with free office hours. Some of the mentors are so dedicated, they come in 2 to 3 times a month for 8 hours a day. We just have open office hours for questions. So sit down and do financial models, do marketing plans with companies for little to no charge. And then they also provide discounted services for services outside of office hours. Each company gets a perks package of $250,000, which is perks that come from Google Cloud for startups, Amazon Web Services, Facebook Start, HubSpot, co-working spaces for after they leave the program after 6 months, as well as a ton of other perks. They get 6 months worth of free office space in this building, and if they're still progressing, they get an additional 3 months. And part of the expansion that we're doing, we're going to add more companies per term, but we're also adding the investment component. So we're, to start, for the really early stage companies, we'll be doing investments of $25,000 to $50,000 per company in the broad industry focus, digital media and technology, which pretty much encompasses everything minus just a couple of things. pretty broad. And then later on this year, we're looking to potentially raise a fund, and then we'll do larger investments for seed stage companies and add a second tier to the pre-accelerator program. So if you're interested, you can follow up with me afterwards, or you can go on to pre-accelerator.com and apply. We're taking applications right now. Without further ado, I'll turn it over to Len.
Thanks, Heidi. Welcome, everybody. There are seats if you prefer to sit, because we're going to do an exercise and it'll be good if everybody's in the room. So if you're standing, come on in. Oh yeah, you finish your sandwich, it's okay. So welcome everybody. As Heidi said, my name is Len Lonzi. I'm the Executive Director of the Los Angeles Venture Association. I've been in that role for the past 9 years, which is hard to believe that anything in this town for the last 9 years. There were no accelerators when I started here in Los Angeles, except for Idea Lab, which was the one that was actually operating 9 years ago. And when we start talking about venture funds, we can get into that in a little bit, but I mean, it's just a whole different landscape today than what it was 9 or 10 years ago. Prior to that, I spent about 20 years in the nonprofit community. I've held roles as the Chief Executive Officer for the Boy Scouts of America and a local Boy Scout Council up in Santa Barbara. I worked for Junior Achievement here in Los Angeles. I was a turnaround CEO for some small nonprofits. So the theme in my world is working in the nonprofit community, helping our world be better. And that's kind of my mission in life, my passion. And I almost look at my job at LAVA as a hobby, because it's so much fun. It's really engaging to meet with new individuals, new entrepreneurs, people with money, people who want money, try to figure out how to put it together. All the connectors in the room of people that connect the people to money, because it's very rare you're going to go into a room and actually meet someone who's going to write you a check. I want to take that off the table right now. Just as we talk about networking for capital, It doesn't happen all that often to go into a room and leave with that $100,000 check in your pocket. And that's just not what it's going to be like.
How about cash?
Depends on what industry you're in. So if you start talking about the green industry, you can maybe change your expectations.
Black market.
So we're going to start with a little introductory exercise. There were supposed to be 90 people here. And there's 34, 35 people. So maybe what I'd like to do is start, we'll do some self-introductions, just so we can get a sense of who's in the room. So what I'd like you to do is just say your name, your business, and your role in the business. That's it. I don't want sentences about your business. I don't want sentences about what you're looking for at this point in time. Just, I'm Len Lonzi, I'm the executive director of Blob. Done. Okay, your turn. Excellent. Well, welcome everybody. We have a really great crew of people. How many people said founder? co-founder, founder, CEO. I mean, you guys are the future of the tech community here in Silicon Beach in Los Angeles. So give yourselves a hand. That's really awesome. And, we have the attorney in the room. And, it's okay, Michael, because what you'll find is Michael might be the most important person you'll meet here tonight because of maybe what his contacts are and how he relates to people in the capital market community. So don't discount that just because there's a lawyer in the room means that it's a wasted energy. He's probably going to be the most connected person here in the sense, and I'm just presuming that. I don't know that for sure, so don't flood the poor guy. Or the retired man. He's had one life cycle anyway, and he's probably has some contacts because of that. So. It's always good to know who's in the room. As a presenter, it's important for me. So one of the exercises I do before I even start this class is Heidi sent me the list noon today of the 90 people who had signed up for this. And believe it or not, I went through everybody's LinkedIn to find out who was in the room. And I saw that I had some friends who were going to be here. John LaRocca, who I haven't seen in a couple of months, a friend of Pontiff, who I knew in a whole nother world when she was back at J.H. Cone. Barbara Bickham, she's been doing lots of different things, and we've been friends for a long time. So as I go through, I want to see who's here, and I'm looking for different things. I'm looking for ways to connect with people, because that's really important. So I want to make a special introduction, because I only get to do this one more time, and that'll be tomorrow. But we have a visitor here from Rome, the company ZegUp. It's a talent instrument. It's an assessment instrument to measure soft skills for hiring and putting teams together. It's a really good proprietary algorithm using a very renowned personality test and that quickly can put you into different teams. Roles, and came out here 2 days ago. We had a day full of meetings yesterday. We met with Cornerstone on Demand and ZipRecruiter, and so I sit on the Italian American Chamber of Commerce West. And so my connection beyond what I do for Lava is also with the Italian Chamber, and we do projects with these companies that come over from Italy and try and connect them into the community to help open up markets for them. So Luigi.
Hi.
Nice to meet you.
Yes,
Andrew. Yeah. Yeah, there's a couple people who speak Italian in here, so that you did also.
Isn't here any Mario?
So we're going to do an exercise right now. So we all know we've got our names and our titles out there. What I want you to do is break up into groups of two or three. I think we'll give it about 10 minutes. What I want you to do is share with each other something about you that you're not going to find in your LinkedIn page. All right? Something that is maybe not business related. All right? And then I'll just pick on a couple of people to kind of report back. So break up into small groups. Take about 5-10 minutes. Introduce yourself. Get to know
you. I know everything about you.
Very exciting.
What did you learn about Serena?
I learned about animals and wellness, that animals are good and we should help them.
Okay.
Yes.
Jude?
They have twins, and like, other than that, they just work and that's it with twins.
Did anybody learn anything interesting about Jude by any chance? You didn't share?
They're asking you, not me.
Virtual reality space.
Oh, he talked about work.
No, I didn't. I didn't really. Oh,
yeah. No, I talked about other things. He's from Sedona.
Yeah. Okay. Good. Drew, you learned anything about something that was cool?
Victor is a certified massage therapist.
Victor. Victor, that was not on your LinkedIn page. It was not there. You're from the Ukraine, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. That was on your LinkedIn. Gabriel Sparusky.
Yeah.
Yeah, da. Right? So. Ukrainsky. Yeah. Wrong language. No, he speaks Ukrainian. I know that. But he said he speaks Russian on his LinkedIn.
I do.
Yeah. I know. I'm just saying. I'm a massage therapist also.
Really?
Yes, I am.
High five.
We can trade sometime. Let's see. Alex, what did you learn over here?
I've learned that I have two guys here to report on. So River likes to travel, but he's never been to Mongolia or Africa. And he likes to go outside, traveling, not kind of vanilla. And Seth has mafia connections. He didn't get that. he's connected. He's well connected.
Okay, so not wrong with that.
He's been in the money room, which, I don't know, that means that he can apply for funds, or?
They don't own it anymore, so it's all good.
All right, so the purpose of this exercise, when you meet people and you're networking, is you want to create that point of, what I'll call that point of intimacy, where you learn something about that person that can connect you to them. Find out about what their passions are, what makes their juices flow, what makes them creative. Because those are the things you're going to remember about the person. If you can find that connectivity. And so the exercise I did before you all came and looking at everybody's LinkedIn page, find something about each person that maybe I can connect with on. And so if you go to a conference or you're going to a networking organization or you belong to a club, if you can find out about the people that are there beforehand, then you know who you want to go meet, because then you can connect to them, because you may speak a similar language, you may be from the same part of the world, you may be from the same university or the same fraternity or sorority, or you both like, you know, French wine. It's whatever you can find that connection. And that's how you can start building what? A relationship. Because that's what networking is building relationships. And as we start talking about networking for capital, there's no secret sauce here. It's, you have to build relationships first. So that's it, we're done. Okay. So what do we mean by networking for capital? First of all, what is capital?
Money.
What else is capital?
Information.
People, human resources, human capital, we have money capital, information capital.
Social capital.
Social capital. There's all sorts of types of capital that whenever you're building a business, if you just had the money and nothing else, would you be successful? Right? Right? If you just have the people and no money, are you going to be successful? Probably not. Yeah, the money, unfortunately, is still the gasoline that makes the engine go.
That doesn't big people.
Right. So, it's important to understand what that capital is, and where do you find capital? So, you know, let's talk about money first. You know, how many people here are actually trying to raise money right now? Raise your hand. Raise it high. Don't be bashful. Okay, so you're trying to raise money right now for your business. And how many people have raised money already? Okay, so we have good half and half. How many people have done both? They've raised money and they're raising money again. All right, so the people who've raised money and are raising money again are probably a step ahead of everybody else, because they already have sources of capital they can
can go to. They have people that can help them. They've also built a reputation of how they spent that money when they raised it the first time. When you think about raising money, and let's talk just from an entrepreneurial startup business, right? Why do people fund businesses? What's the number one reason?
ROI.
ROI, okay, so they're looking for a return on investment. And that might be the underlying motivator, but why do they fund you? Why do they fund your company?
They believe in you.
They believe in you as
what? The idea. They believe in you as a founder.
They believe in the person. Yep. So they have to know you and trust you first and foremost. Yep. You can have the best idea in the world, but if they can't connect with you, they're never going to fund you. They don't. Investors are tricky sorts of people. People fund people, not ideas. So you can have the best idea in the world, but if you can't connect with those people, when you're raising money and you're courting funders or capital, it's like a marriage. It's like dating. You know, you want to find the right people to invest in you, because you're going to be together for a long time. And they're going to have some control over what you do in your business. So it better be a good match from the outset. So, you know, when you start thinking about networking for capital, you know, you need to find out who's out there and who's going to be a good match for you, both from the types of resources that capital can bring, both money and other resources, their connections. You know, why do people come to the pre-accelerator? Ross, why are you here?
Because of connections, structure, mentorship.
Right? It's not just about money. It's about building that whole network around you. So when you're ready to go out to raise money, you have those people in your network. So that's an important piece. What I want to do is spend some time brainstorming where you go to network for capital. You know, what types of groups can you go to, or have you been to, that produce results for you as far as raising capital? So let's start brainstorming. I'm going to write some stuff down. You tell me what to write down.
Sam.
All right, okay. We can start right here. It stops.
I call it.
Yeah. All right. Lava? Did I hear lava? That's good. How many people have been to a lava program in the past decade or so? Good, good. I invite the rest of you to come. I promise it'll be well worth your while. We have one of our group leaders for our mobile group, Mark Honoroff, here, and we have a program coming up in February,
23rd.
February 23rd, and we'll talk about that in a little bit, is what that program is going to be about, because Mark probably doesn't even know you. where else can you buy?
Friends and family.
Friends and family?
And fools, I would say.
Heart Center Tech, because Len is a Heart Center Tech leader recognized by the State Senate.
Angel List,
okay. But Angel List is, how do you meet people through Angel List? Isn't that just
maybe
a list?
Maybe show connections and introduction.
Yeah. Connection. You can't just message people.
Yep. Where else?
Trade shows?
Yep.
Co-working spaces.
Yeah.
We also have connections for former employers or alma maters could be utilized.
How about a funding consultant?
Yeah, funding consultant.
Like us.
Corporate funds.
Consultants.
I think this is probably
Craigslist.
The penny saver.
I don't know if anybody. I have. Has anybody posted on Craigslist and said I'm looking for money? I mean, you can find just about everything else out there on Craigslist. Maybe it's worth trying. I don't know. I've never, John.
Crowdfunding.
Crowdfunding.
Yeah, equity and non.
Yeah, so, you know, you can do a Kickstarter or any of the crowdfunding, I'll just call it crowdfunding.
Credit cards.
Credit cards. Yeah. Well, how do you meet capital through credit cards?
Well, so you use your own.
Oh, just use your own credit card. Yeah.
Well, small business charges.
Your 401k, your savings account.
How about the SBA?
Sell your house, your car.
Okay. So there's a lot of places. A couple things that I want you to kind of think about. When I first came to LA about 15 years ago, I didn't have much of a network in this town. So I used LinkedIn. And I think LinkedIn, by the way, is the Bible of networking. If you know how to use it, it is a really magical tool. Because you can sort. You can say, I want to find anybody that went to the University of Rochester that lives in Los Angeles. And if that's in somebody's, you know, profile, it's going to come up. And that's where I went to school, right? So I went to the U of R. When I did that, you know, I don't know how many names came up, probably 300-400 names. Out of that 300-400 names, I recognized at least a half a dozen people that I went to college with that I didn't even know were living in LA. And I was able to build my network starting there. I was in a national fraternity. Same thing. Put Theta Chi in there. All of a sudden, you know, I see all these Theta Chi brothers from wherever school they are in the United States. Doesn't matter. We have an automatic kinship. I'm Italian American. Put Italian in there. See who comes up, that people who speak Italian or people that have an Italian background. That maybe that's an affinity that I might want to work with. So whatever you can do to build your network, using any type of resource of history that you have, where you can find that commonality, is really going to help you. That's a great starting point. Because it's a lot easier to ask and build a relationship with somebody that you have something in common with, instead of with a perfect stranger. So now that I've opened up those doors, any other ideas come to mind of where you could start building your network? Mark?
Yeah, there's one you missed. Potential clients and customers.
I don't know what you mean.
Like a company that does internal strategic investment.
Okay.
Like Intel or Comcast or
Google,
Amazon, all those
kind of things. Your local church or temple?
Yeah. How about religious institutions? That's also a great way to meet people.
Civic or nonprofits?
Yeah. I belong to the Rotary Club.
Oh.
Right. There's a ton of service organizations that are out there, whether it's Lions Club, Rotary Clubs, Kiwanis Clubs, the Odd Fellows, and Rebecca's.
The Junior League.
What's that?
Junior League,
Chamber of Commerce. All these different groups then start to build your network.
Professional organizations and conferences.
What's that?
Professional
associations and conferences. So these are all places that you can start building your network, because you don't want to go out and say, my name is Len and I need $1 million. Because that isn't going to work. You're going to start building those relationships and you start talking to people about what you do. You ask them what they do. You know, when you start thinking about, and then we talk about this at Heart Center Tech, it's about what you give, not about what you ask for. So find in the people that you met today, think about what you could give to that person that would help them in their business or in their personal life. Or a suggestion, you know, River's never been to Africa. You know, if you have an opportunity or an interest in going to Africa, I could send you places that I've been to in Africa that might be cool or connect you with somebody there. Just knowing something, a little something about somebody, and then keep it in touch with them. So now you're going to build a relationship with people, and think about how you build those relationships. So how do you maintain relationships right now? How do we maintain relationships in our daily life with our friends?
Stay in touch.
All right, so we have the internet, which has been the game changer for us all, right? Facebook.
WhatsApp.
Yeah, I mean, there's tons of those you know, internet-based ways of keeping in touch with people. But don't forget, that's just an internet connection. Keep the personal connection. How many people write notes, thank you cards? You know, I know millennials probably don't want to hear it, but, you know, it goes 1,000 miles because for every card that I send, I know that there's 1,000 people that didn't send one. And that's how people remember you. And they say, wow, that person took time to write a card. Or, better yet, that person sent me a book on something that I thought was interesting. Or they sent me an article in the newspaper. Or they sent an email with an attachment to an article. Keep in touch with people. In fundraising, you know, professional fundraising for nonprofits, we talk about 7 touches with a donor over the course of a year. Well, that can be applied to relationships, too. Maintaining relationships with potential funders, with people that you want to get to know better. Keep it pertinent, keep it something that's personal, something intimate that they'll remember you for. Okay? And did we miss anything up here on our Capital Networks?
It's Alumni Association.
Alumni Association. I've got all the time, so, okay, good. Just check the time here. So, a lot of the syllabus for today comes from an author that I kind of idolize. Has anybody heard of Keith Ferrazzi before? So Keith Ferrazzi wrote the book Never Eat Lunch Alone. Okay, he is kind of my guru on networking, so a lot of the materials I have and a lot of the stuff I've been using today is from his books and from his materials. And I just want to give credit where credit is due. So I'm going to go over a summary of some of the things that come from Never Eat Alone. So build it before you need it. You start building your network now. If you have to raise money right now and you haven't started building that network, you're behind the curve. So if you don't have to raise for a while, start building that network. Go and network in the community. Figure out those people that you want to meet. And then come up with some targets. You know, figure out who you want to meet and figure out how to meet them. How to, you know, find that connector that can do that introduction. Don't be a networking jerk. Okay, so the thought of somebody working a room doesn't make you feel dirty. You know, when you're going to it and you're just passing out business cards kind of indiscriminately. Make it relevant. Make it real. Make it personal. Make it intimate. Don't keep score. Don't worry about what people are going to do for you or what you're doing for them. Just do. I think that's a really important point. We talked about creating intimacy. Be audacious. What does that mean?
Dare to meet someone new.
Yeah. Be daring. Be bold. Don't be the person that sits in the corner and waits for people to come to you. Go out there and introduce yourself. Develop conversational currency. What do you think that refers to?
Have some charm.
Have value.
Something substitute to that. You're not going to talk about the weather. you want to talk about something that's of substance. You may not want to start off, how do you feel about Donald Trump? That might not be the best start off. Conversation starter, you know, stay away from religion, politics, you know, just like at the dinner table. And you want to keep it peaceful. You can get into that later. You know, you can find out if you have a political. Listen first so you can hear what people are saying to you and respond to that. Don't just blurt out stuff. You know. Listen, take time and listen to people. Watch for nonverbal cues. If someone's sitting there like this, tapping, looking at their watch, or they have their phone out while you're talking to them, probably not going very well. And you know, how many people carry their phones with them all the time? It's in your hand as you're talking. And it's a bad habit. I'm very guilty of it. I try when I go to lunch now not to have the phone out, have it off in my pocket. These mobile devices are the death of us all, I think, someday. Drive me crazy. But, you know, be cognizant of the nonverbal cues that you're giving people. Give eye contact with people in the eye because they're going to respond to you that way. this is a real important one as you start to build a relationship. Get to know the gatekeeper of the person that you're working with, that you want to get to know. So if they have an administrative assistant, or they have a person that is their confidant, get to know that gatekeeper so you can figure out how to approach the person that you want to get to know better. And then the one I love is build your personal advisory board. Surround yourself with people that can help get you connected and sound off with them and help. And you help them also. So, you know, you can have a group of four or five people that just get together once a month or once every couple weeks and just talk about who you're meeting and, you know, who you're trying to meet and brainstorm together and use that brain trust of how to meet people. It's a great way of extending your influence and extending your network. Any questions on any of that?
I guess I wonder, maybe it's just a matter of just attentiveness and care, but how do you make sure that when you're doing those touches, it's not like, is something like as simple as, hey, this is what's going on in my neck of the woods, okay? Or is that sort of like lower on the totem pole versus, hey, here's something that's a real like value add, like here's an interesting article.
I think the latter is what you're thinking about as you start making those touches is, you know, what can you give to somebody? Be giving. Don't take, be giving. It does work. It comes back tenfold. I know it sounds a little biblical when I say that. I think there's a parable in the Bible that talks about when you give, you'll get back ten times what you give it. That's true in life. So don't be afraid to give of yourself, offer your help, offer your talent, offer your time, offer your treasure, offer whatever you can to help somebody else, and that will come back to you. Volunteer. That's another great way to meet people. How many people are involved in a volunteer organization? You know, this is a great way to build your network and meet people, because as you do that and you find people with that same passion to be volunteering with, and you share your story and you share what you're doing, all of a sudden, wow, they found somebody that can help me. And you didn't even have to ask for it. What you want to do is create that environment where people will want to be with you because they feel good. And then things will come to you. Let's get a little bit more granular, though. So this is all kind of fluffy and makes you feel good, but now we really have to go out and raise capital. So we want to get to Jim Armstrong at March Capital Partners over in Arizona. You know, how do you get to Jim Armstrong? He's a venture capital partner. He's been very successful, invested in PayPal when he was with his Clearstone Ventures. How do you do that? What's the first, you know, how do you figure out, A, is he the right guy?
Better know somebody.
Better know somebody, but who's the somebody, and how do you find that out?
LinkedIn
is a great way to start.
I try to find somebody speaking somewhere, and then I go to that event and try to reach
social media.
Yeah.
You can find out where people are just by looking at their Instagram or Snapchat.
Absolutely.
I would go to the companies. They have the profiles of the companies he's funded. Look at the people. Maybe I know somebody.
Right.
Either side. Yeah.
Great.
Yeah,
kind of
like
that last comment. It's before you waste any time trying to pursue a high-level contact, you should first figure out if that high-level contact is even relevant. Because you don't want to just spend all that time getting somebody important if there's not some sort of implicit idea of how they could help you, you could help them.
Right. Yeah, so I mean, again, it goes back to dating and figuring out, is this the right marriage for me? Is this person, do they fund my space? So, and so you have to get to know, how do you find out if they fund in your space?
A lot of times on AngelList, they actually explicitly
write. Right, AngelList, so if you have Crunchbase, AngelList, SoCalTech.com, all those resources are out there. You can just go to their website for their investment firm and see what their portfolio looks like. You know, they're going to give you all the companies that they invest in. If you're in that space, you get a pretty good shot. If they're only doing digital media and you're a consumer products in the clean tech space, you know, it's probably not going to be a good match.
But don't you find that you need to actually be referred to them? Like, hi, I mean, delete.
Absolutely. So we were, Luigi and I were doing a program this morning, and we were talking just about that. And we had, I think, four or five angel investors from different up in the stage and one or two venture funds, and absolutely, you know, what they were saying is almost 100% of the deals that they did last year, just talking about the deals they did last year, came through a referral. Came through a referral. Did not come over the transom. They won't even look at the stuff coming over the transom because they, you know, these guys are looking at 40, 50 deals a month, sometimes a day. So there's a lot of competition out there. So you need that warm introduction. So you have to do your homework. So
I think really also you need to, finding that your advisory board is really important, especially somebody that has some kind of credibility in that industry and that believes in your product. So you find an advisor that is within your group or whatever you're doing, and they have some kind of credibility, they're going to introduce you to the right
people. That's right. And that goes back to the service providers that you're going to use in your own business. So when you think about, well, what law firm am I going to use? What attorney in that law firm do I want? What CPA firm or what accounting firm do I want to use? What insurance agent do I want to use? Who are they connected to, and how can they help me get to the where I need to be?
So here, CPAs and lawyers.
I'll put it up. I'm going to make some happy.
CPAs is the way they go. They invest in a lot.
But they're connected to the people with capital.
Exactly.
And the people with capital then trust these. They trust good lawyers. So keep that in mind. If you're working with your sister's brother-in-law, who's an attorney in New York City, and you're here in LA, and they're willing to do whatever work you need done for free, they probably can't connect you to capital here. Maybe they can. Maybe they're well connected. But think about, you know, every decision you make in your business should be run through this filter. How do these people help me build my capital network? Does that sink in? Is that like a little light bulb maybe? Think about that. So let's kind of get some more stories from people. People who've raised capital, raise your hand again. All right, so Mason, you've raised capital for a startup.
Yep.
How did that work for you?
It was interesting, a lot harder than expected, but you live and learn from that. We actually did very well for both our rounds. Amanda and I had a seed round where we just had an idea on a napkin and didn't have anything. And we wanted to raise $500,000. And we went out and spoke to friends and family, and whenever we closed an investor, like let's say I spoke to Len and Len said, sure, I'll invest. And the minute he gave me the check and we signed the stock purchase agreement and the investor rights agreement, I would go, well, Len, is there anybody else you'd refer me to? And that was like one of my most successful actions, because the minute he's invested, he believes in me, he believes in the idea, he believes in the company, and then he goes, well, as a matter of fact, I know three people. All right, could you introduce us? And then that would just lead to other people. And that's how we raised it, and we raised $890,000 for a seed round.
That's awesome. How many investors?
In the first seed round?
Yeah.
About 15, I think.
Okay. Good.
From a napkin?
From a napkin. Awesome. But obviously, your friends and family, those are the people that are going to believe in you the most.
Right.
They know you the most, they're going to believe in you the most, and you know, they're just giving you money at that point. I mean, whether they get that money back or not is irrelevant to the equation. They hope they get it back.
Yeah, they get it back.
But
and we've raised we're in our Series A right now, and we've raised $2 million, and we've got $750,000 to go.
Awesome.
And we've never gone to anybody other than angel investors, friends and family, not a VC, not a private equity, nothing.
Oh, I like your cap table. Jude, what worked for you?
We got our first round from friends and family, and I think it was more just about the excitement of investing into new technology. It was pretty much a hustle, but it was successful in the long run, and it was more, and we had numbers to prove it, so I guess it was, you know, it was successful. But then our second round, we chose to actually just become a service industry with the VR, and we're just providing prototypes and services, and we're getting small chunks of money, but very stable and continual. So it more so turned into a raising capital by providing a service in the industry. So that's kind of what we're doing at the moment.
Okay. Anybody else want to share a success story in raising money? Anybody want to share a horror story in raising money?
I can help.
Victor?
I used to work in Groupon Ukraine, and me and my co-founder, my friend, we decided to do a competitor. It's like a hybrid. So we created cashback model and Groupon to one thing. And we were thinking about, where are we going to get money, right? Because in Ukraine, there is no venture capital system, like no ecosystem, zero. And we decided that we should talk to founder of payment system that acquires Groupon Ukraine. And I emailed to this guy, we met, and after 1 week he called me and he said, I'm gonna give you $200,000. After 1 year of working, he bought this company.
That's awesome. What I like about that story is, think ahead. And I when I work with entrepreneurs, I talk about this all the time. What is your exit plan? Who is gonna acquire you? Best case scenario, name the company. Don't name the industry, name the actual company you think. I think it's going to be Facebook. Great. Now, stop working backwards. How do I build a relationship with Facebook so they understand my business from the very beginning? Maybe they'll be an investor. It could be a corporate investor. Maybe they'll give me some resources. Maybe they'll be maybe I can use them as a vendor however you build that relationship. But keep that focus, and you could end up with a story like Victor where Facebook buys your company. But always have that target in mind. And when you start going out and you start meeting with VCs and they ask you that question, you'd be very specific of what your exit plan is. Don't say, oh, I don't know. Don't ever say that. Always have an exit plan if you're going out for VC money. If you're going for venture capital, angel capital money. You're just doing, you know, if you're going to build a lifestyle business and you're going to own it for the rest of your life, and that's fine. Go do that. But don't do that with venture capital money, because they're not going to invest. Don't think that they're going to invest in you. You have to have some type of liquidity event that pays investors back. And in the venture world and the angel world, they're not interested in dividends. They're not interested in residual income. They're not interested in recurring revenues. They want to pay off at the end. And they're, when they invest in you, they're saying, this is going to be a 25 to 100x of what I put in. That's they're looking for the home run every time. You know how that works with the VC community? Say they have a $100 million fund, right? First of all, whose money is that? Is it theirs?
No.
That's not their money, right? They're just an intermediary. Think of them. They're just brokering somebody else's money. They're going to invest in 10 deals, say $10 million a deal. Guaranteed, 8 of those deals fail. So going in, they know they've lost $80 million already. They know they have to pay their limited partners back at the end of the 10 years, somewhere around 17% IRR. Okay, that's kind of what the average has been over the past 20 years. So that means they're going to make the $100 million back plus, and they only have two companies left to do that with. So if you're one of those two companies, you have to hit it big in order for them to be able to make that money back. So just keep that in mind, that they're looking for the home run.
For those who pitch to VCs, what do they use? Do you use like a slide deck? Did you use your business plan? What exactly, what materials do you bring to kind of showcase
great,
your business, what they ask?
Great question. So you use a different piece at different times of engagement as you're building the relationship. So maybe you've been connected, you've had a warm introduction, maybe you're going to go meet with that VC first time. Maybe you bring a slide deck with you, but maybe what you say is, I'm looking for your feedback. I want your expertise. You know, maybe at that point you're not asking for money. Maybe you're saying, I'm new with this, I think I have a good idea, I know we have a good team. Would you take a look at this and give me some feedback on it?
I think that's really, really good advice. That's actually the number one complaint that I've heard from venture capitalists and from angel investors, is that when they get pitched to by entrepreneurs and entrepreneurs are coming in and they're all high strung because
So if you go in and bring it as a conversation and building a relationship, as I mentioned, that it takes the edge off and it opens the conversation. So approach it just from a different angle than the pitch permit.
Yeah, have some humility. Right? Don't be afraid to ask people for help. I mean, a lot of times people are in the venture capital business not because they want to deploy money, because they have a skill set that they really see as valuable and they want to help companies. They really want to help companies grow. At the end of the day, they want to make money. But they know that in order for them to do that successfully, they have to help build good, solid companies that can have that hockey stick projectile and take off.
You know, it depends on the VC companies, really, because you know, if you talk to some people that were just mainly a financial background, they're a Wharton graduate or whatever, they've never really gone out and started a company or been a startup. You know, they've just got a job, they've got a salary, and they just look at numbers and they don't have any idea what it takes to run a startup. So it's a little bit sort of demoralizing at some point. But if you talk to VC who has actually gone and invested in companies or started their own companies, then they sort of have more understanding on what it takes.
Right, and you know, if you look at most of the VC partners here in Los Angeles, and I can name off a ton of them, they all have operating experience at some point.
Yeah.
Or they've worked in public companies, or they, you know, a lot of them actually come out of the accounting. For some reason, there's a lot of people that are E&Y grads, or you know, they've come out of the accountancy side of things. You have IP lawyers that, you know, have done well, and then they'll become a VC partner. So they all have a specialty. So when you pick that person that you want to invest in, you pick that person for a skill set. You know, you're interviewing them as much as they're interviewing you.
Yeah.
And you know, you're going to meet people from VC firms and just institutional firms. And there's a hierarchy in those firms. You have general partners, you have partners, and then you have the associates, and you have the analysts. And a lot of times when you go to networking groups, you meet the analysts and you meet the junior associates. You know, they're not necessarily the decision makers. So you don't have to sell them on a slide deck. You just have to sell them on yourself and the idea and the enthusiasm to get in the door. So know each piece of that puzzle.
To see if you're really locked into your idea, if you can be derailed very, very easily, then they lose interest right away.
All right, so passion, that's a gauge of passion. But then again, you don't want to be so stubborn that you can't pivot, right? That you can't change direction because, oh my God, this is not going the way I thought it was going to go. How many people have had to pivot in a business? I've had to do it a couple different times. You know, you think you're going to go in one direction, all of a sudden you're going the opposite direction because that's where the road is going to take you. Any other stories or more stories, good or bad? Anybody have a really bad meeting? I always learn from the things that go wrong. It's really hard to learn from things that go right. I like to find out what not to do. Yes, sir?
Yeah, yeah. Interesting one. So I was trying to get a film financed. And I went into a meeting with a well-known guy. And we were talking for a long time. It was very friendly. It was very chatty. And at some point, I just mentioned that we had also talked to someone else. He got up and he said, "This meeting is over. Thank you."
Yeah, I guess you have to know who their enemies are, right?
It wasn't a matter of an enemy. It was in this business, everyone wants to be the only one who sees a project.
And I see that in Los Angeles in the venture market. There's some competitiveness between the funds here. You know, there's some funds that want those deals first. And they don't want you to be talking to other VCs, so you know, get to some of that's a little overt. It's not too overt. Up in Sand Hill, in the Bay Area, that doesn't exist all that much. Actually, all those guys play very nicely together in the sandbox. They like to co-invest. They like to syndicate their deals. LA hasn't figured that out as well. And I think a lot of it is some of the mindset of the entertainment industry that brought that into it.
Big egos.
Big egos. John, you had your hand up.
Yeah, it's often quite interesting because when you begin a conversation to begin to look for money, it's always the first part. It's like you said at the beginning, you never want to walk in and get out your $100,000 in the first 10 minutes of the first conversation.
John, so you know where he's coming from. John used to be in the talent management area in a past life and worked with talent managing their lives. So he understands what that feels like. And, he doesn't do that anymore. He now does credit card processing. It's a whole different world. But he's a good guy if you need that service. Yes, Heidi.
I just have a story about an introduction that I had made for funding to a substantial funding source here in LA. It was a partner from Greycroft. And so my point is going to be that you treat your introductions that you get from your referral sources as kid gloves, and you treat them with respect, because it's not so much, well, and any pitch that you make to a VC, it may not seem, Ms. Johnson, it may not seem like it's going anywhere in that pitch session, but 24 hours later, they may have time to think about it. 6 months down the road, a year down the road, when they're in a different place, they may come back and be interested in your idea after you've scaled a little bit, or after they're ready, when the market is ready. So I've had, there was one instance where I made an introduction and the person didn't show up for the meeting. And it was supposed to be actually an in-person meeting and the company late. And then later on, oh, could I have another meeting? And burned that bridge.
Yeah.
And but there's been another instance just recently where I think when I'm friends with the investor, so they'll take other referrals from me, but he came back to me and said, you know, is this one of your companies? He said he'd never been so insulted in his entire career because the company wasn't teachable. And they got very defensive and they were asked questions. And the reason he was asking their tough questions is because he was probing because he was kind of interested and he wanted to dig deeper. But it was, there were questions that were controversial and were, you know, were touchy for that particular company because that's the things that they were struggling with. And so I think just the lesson is that the teachability aspect, but also, you know, keep an open mind that whether or not they're ready for you right now, they may be ready for you later.
Yeah, and that was one of my next points, Heidi, but that's all right, we'll talk about it now. Be respectful. Those of us that connect people to capital, that do those warm introductions, that will take a risk on somebody that I try to get to know the people that I'll do introductions for before I make the introduction. And my reputation's on the line when I send it out to a capital provider. Because it will come back to me, what the hell are you doing sending this garbage to me? Or these people aren't prepared, or they were rude, or they were late, or you know, they dressed like slobs. You know, think about, this is serious business. These guys and women that are funding companies, this is serious business for them because there's a lot of pressure on them to perform. So they want to make sure that they do a good job. And that, I'll get to you in a second, John. That's true of anything in life. You want to treat everybody respected. This is a small city, as big as Los Angeles is. In this transactional world of the venture capital community, and the startup community, how many people do you think are really involved in Los Angeles in that world?
3 degrees of separation.
It's probably less than 10,000 people total. When you think about all the startups that are out there raising money and all the money that's out, the people that are out, you know, looking at money, the people that are connecting, it's not that big of a community. So if you screw up and create a reputation for yourself, really hard to, you have to move. You have to move. I mean, we've had people come into town who were in town who had bad business dealings and leave for a while and come back and try and do business, and it didn't work. And that's because they never made amends. So it's okay to make mistakes and apologize and do the mea culpa or whatever you need to do to regain that trust. But once you burn that bridge, especially with money, it's very difficult for it to be repaired. So don't take the lessons of what is it, Silicon Valley, the TV show. Don't use that as your basis of how to operate. It actually does a pretty good job of satire in the industry. In some cases, a little bit too close to home. But don't look at that as the way to make it work. Any other questions, observations from anybody? Jude, yes, sir.
Yeah, I think this was kind of a little secret to success I just want to share. You know, any company you have, you want to become the authority in that business, no matter.
matter what it is. And we started hosting meetup groups and giving back as a way to just share what we know and what we're doing. So we started a virtual reality meetup group, and it's become one of the best and biggest in Los Angeles. And that became a funnel for a company. And so we ran around trying to raise capital, but then we just decided to sell to the people that came to us through the meetup groups. And we're surviving based on funnels of giving back to the community what we know about virtual reality and augmented reality and mixed reality, and we share it with people. And through that, they know other people, and they bring people in that have money, and they want to build prototypes, and they want to do stuff. So by giving back through networking and becoming the authority in what your business is, and by giving back through it, we've somehow created a lifestyle business where we're no longer doing the VC race, but we're focusing on giving back to these funnels that we build, and it's more of like a marketing HR thing for the company. And we also create apprentices and people that want to learn that actually give their time to us to help work on our projects so they can learn from things. So it's kind of unorthodox and it's a little bit different, but as we're building and scaling and trying to become more of a company that can show ROI to get VC stuff, we give back by creating meetup groups and sharing our wisdom and knowledge of what we know of the business that we're in. And just in that giving back phase, it's like tenfold comes back to us. Yeah. And that was kind of a heart-centered tech kind of thing that we had done with people that had been successful in LA, and we've learned from them, and they all talk like Len about creating and getting people together and sharing your wisdom and knowledge. And if you just give it away for free, and help people in some way with that, and it's just a couple hours a week, it can really pay off, and it also helps your marketing to become an authority in business. So I just wanted to share that.
Thanks,
part
Drew.
Of it.
Appreciate that. Yeah, Mark.
Yeah, we do the same thing. I wasn't really thinking about it as a technique before, but I do a lot of public speaking, but even not as a public speaker, I run 6 meetup groups and financially support 8 others. Because I do a lot of work in film, and besides, obviously, capital, there's an enormous lack of education, financial and otherwise. So I support not only finance, but a lot of finance and marketing kinds of teachers that are not always me as a speaker, but a lot of others, too. I have 24,000 in my meetup groups just in L.A., and yeah, that really does work for us.
Good. Thank you. Any other couple of tidbits of wisdom? Remember, you want to be in a room of people smarter than yourselves. Look for quality groups. There's a lot of networking opportunities and organizations and companies that come and do programs here in Los Angeles for the startup community. Be choosy on which ones you go to. Look for the ones with quality, with the best speakers. Be careful the ones that are charging a lot of money, and because of what the perceived value of that might be or not be. Do your homework before you go to that conference and see who's going to be there, who you can meet. So it becomes, you have some ROI beyond all the handouts that you walked out with and the little gizmos and gadgets and things that you get when you go to these things. This is an unconventional thing to say, but if you don't need venture capital money, don't take it. Build your company on revenues if you can. Fund your growth through revenue as much as possible. And then when you get to that precipice where you have to, where you have that opportunity to grow, where you're ready to scale, then go out for a round. Most VCs, institutional funds here in LA, aren't going to fund you unless you have some type of traction and revenue and customers. Not eyeballs, but actual money coming in. Have a revenue model. Don't build a company without income or perceived income. We all can't be Snapchat. And time will tell on what happens in 2 months with Snapchat is whether they're going to be successful in that IPO or not. Build value with the people that you bring to the table. Build value with customers that you're going to have. build value with the quality of the product or service that you deliver. So we're going to get close to the end here, and I want to start. So we all attend conferences, and I thought I'd leave you with some words of wisdom on, you know, when you go to a conference, how to make the best of that. So there's 15 of you that have a piece of paper in your hand that I said that you would be using later. They're numbered 1 through 15. So who has number 1? All right, Seth, no problem. You have a piece of paper that you were supposed to read?
Yeah, it's right there, but there's somebody else that's there.
Who's got number 1? Proper prior planning prevents piss poor performance. That's military strategists know that most battles are won before the first shot is fired. The side that determines where, when, and how an engagement is fought usually gains an insurmountable advantage. So get focused. Take time, weeks before the conference, to think through and write down why you're attending, what you want to achieve, what you want, who you want to meet. And the more clearly you articulate what you want and need from the conference, the more likely you can plan and execute your mission. So don't do things in a trivial way. Put some focus into it. Who's got number 2?
Get the list of conference attendees somehow. Call the conference organizers, ask your friends who are going if they know of other attendees, or whatever it takes. Then go through the list and note those you want to meet. Keep that list with you at all times during the conference, including social events, so you know whom you've met and whom you still need to meet.
Right. So know your targets. Number 3.
Gather intelligence. If you want to get to know someone, the first thing you should do is figure out how you can help them. Google them. Of course, their business interests will be most obvious, but do some deeper research to learn about their human sides. Then find your currency for them, your experience, knowledge, contacts, or resources that can make them more successful. And get this, the best part of doing your homework is that it doesn't have to be a secret. When you meet your target contact, say, I always make a special effort to inquire about the people I'd like to meet. Inevitably, people are flattered. Wouldn't you be?
Think about that. Number 4, strike early.
Strike early. Don't wait for the conference to start your networking. A week or two beforehand, pick up the phone and call at least the top 3 people you want to be sure to meet. And no whiny excuses about not being able to find their coordinates. This is the information age! Exclamation point. Begin your conversations now and or arrange a time for when you arrive at the conference. Can't get past their gatekeepers? Surprise them with a fax or a voice message when they arrive at the conference, and save them from spending the night alone in their rooms, most likely in the very hotel where you're staying. Say, I'll be downstairs at 8 with a few people for drinks and dinner. Would you like to join us?
That's pretty good.
Number 5, build your brand.
Before you walk into the conference, adopt the first of 4 mindsets for relationship building: generosity. The other 3, vulnerability, candor, and accountability, will come in handy too. But generosity is where it all starts when it comes to building a strong foundation for your brand. Make sure that when you're interacting one-on-one with people that you are leading with authentic generosity, that means being willing to help without keeping score.
That's good. Out. You don't have to go for the rest of it. Mm-hmm. That's a long paragraph. Number 6, slight the speakers.
Don't waste time standing in line to meet a speaker after his or her song and dance. There will be so many other brilliant people at the conference. Go meet them. If you must meet the speakers, please approach them before their talks, before they have captivated the crowd's attention and their adoration. That way, you won't waste precious time standing in line, or have your ability to create impact diminish by becoming one of the dozens. Fans.
How many people, you know, waited in line?
If you're already standing in line, talk to people behind and in front.
Exactly. Yeah, make use of that time. But I mean, it's hilarious. We'll do these programs. We, you know, I'll have 4 or 5 venture capital panelists, and at the end is like a line 10 deep for people to get in to meet these guys just to shake their hand. And are they really going to remember that?
Yeah.
So if you can make that connection beforehand, it's much more memorable. Number seven, I love this one. Get a wingman.
Yeah, this is a good one. Get a wingman. Just as people lose weight more effectively if they have a workout partner or a formal accountability group, to start more of the relationships you want if you team up. If possible, set such partnerships in motion and advance the conference. But if not, just be ready to be on the lookout for the right match as soon as you arrive. You and your buddy can provide each other motivation, guidance, and assistance if you'll share with each other your real reasons for attending the conference. Whether it's to look for a new job, to fill your sales pipeline, or maybe even to seek a romantic relationship. This is the time to embrace a couple more of the mindsets I mentioned earlier, vulnerability and candor. Wouldn't it be great to show up to the conference with somebody who's actually on your side, who's got your back, and who's working with you?
Yeah, don't go to conferences alone if you can avoid it. Number eight, draft off the big kahuna.
Draft off the big kahuna. Get to know some of the most well-known folks at the conference or the conference organizers themselves and hang with them. The important people will rotate by them sooner or later. If you're there, you'll meet everyone who matters. And if you need to reach out to someone who doesn't happen to swing by, ask your new friend, a big kahuna, for an introduction.
All right.
We all know you.
What's that?
We all know you, so that's enough.
That's fine. I don't know about big. I don't know about a kahuna either. All right, number nine. Find a way to help everyone. Who's got that one? Number nine? All right. We've already talked about generosity. Now, what kind of currency can you create that applies to everyone you meet? One easy, broad, helpful option is to become an info hub by becoming an expert on the conference program, just as you said earlier. Then pick the brains of conference staff and anyone else willing to share the ins and outs of what's happening in and around the big meeting. If you're in the loop on the private parties and after-hours special events, everyone will come to you for the goods. Number 10, work hard on break. Did not someone get this or people left? Okay. Don't run off and stuff your face and check email in between sessions. You should attend to your bagel and BlackBerry. This was written a while ago. While boring speakers like me are babbling on and on, so when break time comes, you can get out there and do what you really came to do at the conference and network. Meet people. Number 11, I like this one.
Pack a dinner. Like go to a conference and find the table in advance and scan the schedule and find the right time to organize your own mini event. Or arrange a dinner somewhere in the town with people about a topic that matters to you. Or modify a conference meal and have people and invite people to a join you at a specific table. There's usually no assigned seating, and you can tell the conference organizer that you prefer to reassign yourself. They exist to make the conference better for you.
So I'll do that when I go to a conference. If there are round tables of 10, I'll save 9 spaces around me and then invite people to sit with me. That way I create the atmosphere of the people I want sitting at the table, and I'm not stuck sitting with people I don't know. Or don't need to know. Number 12, let your guard down and find a way to care. Who's got that?
I have.
Go for it.
Let your guard down and find a way to care. When you walk into a room, make it your mission to find at least one person that you could care about. When you see the room through those eyes, you become more authentic, more confident, and more open to connecting. As important, when you engage a target contact, don't you dare talk about the weather. It makes no impact at all. Skip the small talk and dive into the stuff that really matters to you and them. Interests, passions, struggles, and greatest needs. You'll have to push yourself to be human and open up enough to get your acquaintance to start sharing. Then listen, listen, listen with warmth and sincerity. And if you're able to help them, do so. Intimacy and giving are the two keys to making quick connections that jumpstart lasting relationships.
Cool. Number 13, mastering the deep bump.
Master the deep bump. Once you've successfully taken your conversation with a new acquaintance down deep, past the shallow small talk, secure an invitation to reconnect later. Then bump. Move on and meet more people. Don't be like the codependent ankle hugger who thinks the first person he meets is his best friend forever. You've invested too much time and money in this conference not to take the opportunity to meet many different people. You have a lifetime to build relationships with people at the conference, but only a few days to meet them.
Good insight.
Is that Master the Deep Bump?
Yes.
The Deep Bump.
Yeah. You gotta know Keith to understand that. Okay, number 14, take names and make commitments.
Before you conclude the Deep Bump and move on after making an acquaintance, be sure to get a business card. Of course, you should quickly scan the card and say the person's name aloud to help commit it to memory. Furthermore, flip over the card and jot down a few words to remind yourself of what you two discussed, or nowadays you probably just some app for that. Any relevant personal details you wish to remember, and of course, when and why you're going to follow up later.
Stop for a second. This will stop. Just a couple things on business card etiquette. Don't write in front of the person. Don't take notes on it in front of the person. In the Asian culture, you don't want to do that at all. In Japan or China, you know, that business card is their calling card. It's a very significant thing. So the last thing you want to do is stop taking notes on the back of it in front of them. What I do is I take those cards to the side or later on that evening and jot notes down. Okay, sorry.
No, it's no problem. When you feel you've made a special connection, be sure to make a commitment to each other. Accountability is the final mindset for building deep, sustainable relationships. Presumably, you've shared some of your mutual passions and goals, perhaps even some of your challenges. Get specific enough to make a commitment to each other to follow up after the conference. Have you moved your goals forward? If not, how can you help each other do that? Stack. Making mutual commitments creates the trusting bond that can change your life. What I call lifeline relationships.
Excellent. And the last one, follow up or fail?
Follow up or fail. Don't wait until you return home from the conference to ping people whose cards you collect. Shoot out follow-up emails each night of the event or write them during your flight home. That is, unless you want that same rubber-banded stack of cards on your desk a year from now, which is probably the result of last year's conference if you went as a commoner and not a commando.
All right. Any questions or comments on any of that, John?
I think he also mentioned a very good idea, which you and I have both done, and that is on a lot of these conferences, you may want to just give a call to the management people and find out if you can volunteer your time and efforts. You'll find that behind the scenes, you meet a lot of people that know where we're all eyes wearing, and it's really a pretty technique.
Good job. Thank you. Any other comments, questions? Yes, Ross.
I guess for me, like in terms of my industry, I am going to comic conventions a lot, which is awesome and great, and it's a fantastic networking opportunity. The only issue is that, you know, I leave the convention. I've been networking pretty much the entire weekend working the convention floor. It's awesome. It's great. It's just a ton of fun, and it's also very helpful from a business perspective. My only issue is that I have a ton of business cards from a ton of different types of people, all of which could presumably add some sort of value in the future. Now, I'm looking at the software program to help me sort of kind of automize the reminders and the seven-touch cadences like you discussed. I just wonder, other than kind of software tools, are there any sort of strategies? Maybe it's just a matter of like, hey, we've got to just, you know, make tranches and get rid of the ones that don't matter so much. But when you have like a lot of high-touch, potentially valuable networking connections after something, that, like an industry conference, for example, how do you make sure that it doesn't all, because right now it's just like, you know, like you have LinkedIn connections, and after a while it just feels like contact overload. You're like, how do you sort it all out, I guess?
So I have an answer for that, Jason. Does anybody else want to try and tackle it first, Drew?
We have an IR database, so we track each touch. So I know the last five things that were said to somebody, who said it to them, when our next follow-up is either scheduled for or automatically set it for 2 months from now or 2 weeks from now or whatever it may be. And it's just like a workflow. If somebody falls off, then they're closed. You don't have to touch them anymore. If somebody's like, call me when you're doing your Series B, I mark them as Series B, and then when the Series B starts, I mass email everybody that was on the Series B list. So it takes a while to set up, but once you have a system going and you can tweak it as you go, it's a lot easier to manage bulk contacts like that.
What's it called?
I did it through Jira.
I was going to tell you, so it's one of our perks. So yeah, with HubSpot, we're CRM for Perks, and then Facebook Perks.
So the way I'd answer that question, Jason, is I would say you didn't go in with a plan of who you wanted to be. And I would say that if you could find, or, you know, come up with the top 10 people that you wanted to meet and focus on that, and everybody else you meet, you filter in. But, you know, remember, you want to keep pay attention to the big rocks that are out there, you know, people that you really want the help from. You are going to meet, by happenstance, a lot of people. I use LinkedIn as my CRM. That's how I tag people. So everybody in this room tonight who is here, you know, you'll get a LinkedIn request from me. By the way, there's a couple of you, and I won't name you, don't have a LinkedIn profile. If you want to really, if you're serious about networking for capital, don't be anonymous, because people are going to want to do some research on you too. So put your best foot forward online and manage your online profile. So I encourage you to do that. That being said, I'll tag everybody and let them at Sam, Precelerator, you know, on this date, and that I'll keep track of the people that I need to keep track of. So
you don't maintain an independent database from LinkedIn? That's your
source? God, no, because then I'd have two. You know, I have 4,000 people in my database on LinkedIn. They're all people I've met. I do not accept blind invitations to LinkedIn. I'm not an open networker. Only way you get into my LinkedIn network is if I've met you or had a conversation with you on the phone. I'll take a phone conversation. When people blind send me, I want to connect with you, and I have no idea who they are, I send them a kind little note saying, thank you for trying to connect with me. This is a closed network, and I prefer to keep it closed so it's relevant to my contacts. If you'd like to get to know me, I'd be happy to meet with you or have a coffee or have a phone conversation. I get about a 10% return on. Meaning 90% of the people that tried to get in touch with me don't even pay attention to it.
Wow.
So it didn't matter in the first place. So the 10% that actually reach out, I'll reach back out to. That's how I do it, because I just couldn't imagine trying to export all that stuff into Salesforce or whatever else is out there and manage it. So it's not perfect, but I'm not running a big organization. I'm running me.
Yeah.
And those are my contacts. No one else has to see. Any other questions, observations? We're getting to the point now that it's open for questions. I'm done with the syllabus.
I'll throw one up. I'm software. In addition to that, I really like Evernote. The CEO of Evernote, it's a big, like the CEO had a background in OCR. So once you scan a business card, you can throw the business card out, but the software from the server side is automatically redoing algorithms and scanning the language, the writing on the business card so that you don't have to. And so it's a nice tool for scanning business cards to get rid of business cards.
I've tried using Evernote, and it just looks too confusing. I'm pretty simple when it comes to stuff. I still can't figure out my Outlook and my Gmail and how it all works. So, any other questions, observations? Yes?
I was quite curious about how you got in from the nonprofit sector into the very much for-profit sector.
It's an interesting question. So, first of all, LAVA is a nonprofit organization. We're not a for-profit, we're a 501c6. And I was recruited by the board to be the executive director. We've never had a full-time executive director in the organization until I came on board 10 years ago. And the reason why they asked me, at least I think why, is I have a skill set specific to recruiting volunteers, retaining those volunteers, and getting the most out of those volunteers to do work for the organization that I don't have to pay for. Thank you, Mark. And so that skill set that I developed working with the Boy Scouts. I was a professional scouter, but I worked with all volunteers, parents of kids, and got a lot of mileage out of people. And that skill set is what translates well into this job. That's what makes it. Our overhead's very low. We don't have an office. You know, they basically have me and, you know, whatever things I have to do to make the organization run.
The seven touch rule for nonprofits, is there like a standard amount of touches for a VC or an angel investor typically? And does it vary between angels and VCs?
I think that seven touch rule is just, you know, how you maintain relationships. It could be with your second cousin, you know. It's how you maintain relationships. I mean, if you exchange holiday cards, you know, with people once a year, I don't know how deep that relationship is. Although I do look forward to that one card that I get from that person that I only hear from once a year. And if I don't get it, I figure they die. So you know, that seven touches is a good rule of thumb of consistency and being relevant. And that doesn't have to be the same methodology of touch each time. It could be a phone call, it could be a note, it could be an email. Any other questions? You've been a delightful crowd tonight. Thank you so much for your participation.